Hello students, welcome to this third session on The Hindu View of Life, a book by Dr. S. Radhakrishnan. As we had discussed earlier, that in these lectures, this is a collection of lectures by Dr. Krishnan to the Western world. And in his previous three lectures, he has defined what Hinduism is, and what are its brief, its basic principles, basic tenets. And philosophically speaking, Hinduism is a mode of living and it is not a form of thought. It means that Hindu thought stresses upon basically the way of life. It is the, basically a way of life. And here comes the theory of karma. What does this doctrine of karma say? Say that karma means the virtuous life or the ethical life. These are the rules of law. And the rules of law are not only in the outer nature, but they control our mind and thought also. So karma is the spiritual necessity of every human being as per the Hindu thought. Karma represents mind and God's will, and it means that the every action of the human beings, it is weighed in the scale of justice by the individual and the but the universal power, and that is God. And karma along with bhakti and jnana is the pathway to liberation, that is moksha. Now this doctrine of karma has two sides, two aspects. One is the individual aspect and other is the social aspect. In the individual aspect, it emphasizes upon the four stages of life, which are the four ashrama that we had discussed in our earlier session. Now today's session is based on the social aspects of the doctrine of karma. And here comes the caste system or the varnashram. So what does this caste system mean? What does this caste system stand for? Radhakrishnan says that racial problem in India is unique, and the caste system in India is complex in its origin. That is, there are various castes here based on race, tribe, and there are sectarian caste, occupational caste. And he says that originally the caste stood for the skin color, because the Sanskrit word varna, varna means color, color of the skin. Then there were various invasions from the outside world also in India, and due to these invasions, different castes were formed. So caste system is very much unique in India. And this caste system here, it illustrates the spirit of comprehensive synthesis. That is, here all the outside people, all the tribes, they are acknowledged, their individuality is acknowledged here. And this caste system is the outcome of tolerance and trust. Now, in the modern world, we see the racial conflicts are arising very fast. The people are becoming racially conscious, and this racial conscious has given rise to the conflicts between various races for survival. And what is the solution to remove this racial conflict? Is the solution to these conflicts? Radhakrishnan says that in history we see there were four types of solutions applied on the society. First is extermination, then subordination, identification, or harmonization. Extermination is the removal of the entire race from the face of the earth. So it is a violent method and it involves bloodshed. And it was the method which was commonly adopted by the countries throughout the world. But in Hinduism, this method is considered to be unwise and wrong method, because Radhakrishnan says, every race has its uniqueness, it has its own potentialities and possibilities, And if we exterminate these races, then their potentiality and possibilities go unexplored. And this is a very inhuman way and inhumane, and it is the violation of life also. Second solution is subordination of the races. This was also applied in the world. And subordination means when extermination is impossible, then the superior races, they try to enslave the inferior races. And in the process, they make them slaves, and then they spare the slaves, but smash the rebels. They kill the rebels. This method is also inappropriate and unethical, because what is the meaning of civilization? Civilization is not the suppression of weak or less capable races. Civilization is to give equal opportunity and independence to all. Identification is also rejected by Dr. Radhakrishnan, as this is an impossible task because every race has its particular temperament and mentality, which is the product of long centuries of social traditions. And racial fusion or uniformity is an impractical solution. Now he comes to the Hindu solution to this racial conflict. Says Hindu solution is, Hindu thought believes in harmonization of various races. It is a democratic method, and he says that it is the only safe method for the world peace and harmony. This method recognizes the uniqueness and specificity of each race, and it allows them to develop the best in them without impeding, without stopping the progress of the others. So it believes in cooperation, in harmony, in tolerance, and it is the affirmation of infinite diversity of human groups. He gives the example of Vedic Aryans. Says that Vedic Aryans, they believed in Manav Dharma. Manav Dharma is, which is universally accepted in the Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. Our scripture says that whole of the earth is just like a family. And here he gives the example of our great religious leaders. For example, Rama, Krishna, and Buddha. They all brought together Aryans and the non-Aryan races. And this harmonization is a two-way process, because both the natives and the settlers, they are benefited by it. And it is a give and take process. And in this process, nobody has to surrender their originality also. So it is very much elastic method, and it accommodates the indigenous population also. And on the other hand, it rigidly secures the Aryan Hindu ascendancy. Now he says that every caste has its own customs, its own traditions, and its own beliefs. And these traditions, customs, beliefs, they are the inheritance of centuries. So racial amalgamation is the best method, but he says that this racial amalgamation, it should not be indiscriminate. That is, it should be a well thought out process. Hinduism does not encourage indiscriminate racial amalgamation. Though in practice, we see in our past that there was the practice of interbreeding prevalent in the society, but this practice of interbreeding was carefully regulated. The intermixing of the upper and lower caste was controlled. In the scriptures, the Manu says that upper caste man can marry the lower caste woman, but vice versa was not allowed. Now, further he says that Hindu thoughts believe in the inheritance of traits. Though the environment also has effect on the character building, but more importance is given to the hereditary traits. That's why Hinduism favors swarna marriage, that is the same caste marriage. That is, or some relaxation is given. If marriages are in within the different caste, then these should not, these should be among the members of approximately the same level of culture and social development. And he says that this thought is endorsed by, it is supported by Greek thoughts, Greek philosophers also like Plato and Aristotle. In their theories, they also believed in the biological selection, the process of biological selection. And they called it that process of biological selection is the best method for race improvement. Modern science also favors it, like Darwin, Galton, and De Vries. They proved the role of inheritance in preservation of traits, and this role is much more than the environmental factors. And as the Greeks thought, that good will come from good. Now, how did the caste arise in Hindu religion? Says various outside factors, they pressed against Hinduism. And the caste was an answer to these outside factors. And what does this caste mean? Caste means any group of people who appear to be exclusive and they represented a type. This was the caste. And Hinduism stands for ordered complexity, the harmonized multiplicity, and caste was an instrument in the society to civilize different tribes. In the present times, he says that increasing the racial self-consciousness and conflicts are increasing. For example, the blacks in the Western world, they are demanding their share in power, and under such circumstances, Hindu method of blending and mingling the only solution. We should consider the earth as a great family, and in this mingling and blending, each race will retain its specialities simultaneously and developing whatever is best in it. Further, he says, socially speaking, a caste is not created by God. Caste is made by society. It is the product of human organization, and it had a purpose. The purpose was to regulate the society. He says that society is an organic whole where all the groups work for the common end of fulfilling wants of society, sense of unity and brotherhood. That is, each contribute to the whole while taking care of each part. So all groups should act, they should be bound together by unity and brotherhood. This social organization in Hinduism is fourfold. That is, there are the four types of caste. The Hindu society was divided into four sections. One first section, which looked after the cultural and spiritual needs of human beings, that section was called Brahmins. Second, who looked after the military and political needs of the society, they were Kshatriyas. And the economic classes were called the Vaishyas, and the unskilled workers, they were called the Shudras. And he says that each group has its own perfection. And each group is important for the society because each has its own social purpose, its own function, code and tradition. And every group is free from any interference from other group, and each contribute to the growth of society. Now, what are the rules of caste? And he says that social adjustment of different castes was done by specific rules. Brahmins, they were allowed freedom and leisure to develop and spread the spiritual ideals. They were freed from the care of existence, and these Brahmins, they were men of thought, and they were free from the bondage of state. Their aim was spiritual pursuit, and they worked for the welfare of society. And further he says that these people rank highest in the society because these Brahmins, they were not bound by the economic pressures. That is, they didn't give value. They were the least paid section of the society. So there is no relationship between economics, between the finances and the status of the caste in the Hindu thought. Second community is Kshatriyas. Kshatriyas are the men of action, and they used to maintain order and peace in society. And when there was need for force to curb the antisocial animals, then they used the force also to curb them, to subdue them. Vaishyas are the economic group. They are the men of feeling, and they had a moral responsibility to serve the society. Vaishyas were not allowed to hoard the money. Rather, that money was used for community, for the welfare of the society. And the last group in the hierarchy is that of Shudras. Says that the people who had no above quality in highly developed form, they were called the Shudras. They were the unskilled workers, and they used to work in cooperation with each other. This group included peasants, proletariats, and he calls these people as the actual working or actual living members of social structure. What are the principles of social life then? How do all the castes live together? He says that there were accepted social law of harmony and cooperation, and there was no cold or rude competition between different society for earning money. All the castes, all the categories, they lived in harmony and they cooperated with each other. Radhakrishnan says that man who is born to a particular group, he is trained to its manner. So it is difficult to adjust to new ways of other caste. So he says, therefore, change of dharma or function of one caste was unacceptable to Hindu religion because it may destroy the individuality of the being. Here Radhakrishnan quotes Bhagavad Gita, says, according to Bhagavad Gita, I quote, divisions of caste are in accordance with each man's character and aptitude, which are decided by heredity and training. The work was considered a service, work was considered a vocation, and it had traditions and spiritual aims. Gita says that work should be done with non-attachment, and it is done with an urge to create beauty in the world. Therefore, no work was considered to be degrading slavery, nor was it done grudgingly or for purely economic gains. People in India, the Hindu people, they derived pleasures from their work and they craved for perfection in them. That's why it was not burdensome for them. And no work was considered mean in the Hindu society. And it was the spiritual aim of each group to perfect their specific function. And in their work, the workers found fulfillment. And work was considered to be an expression of life. But he says, in the modern world, materialism has snatched this pleasure. Materialism has mechanized the world. Work has become mere labor, and no inner satisfaction is derived from it. In the modern industrialized India, we see everywhere that the artistic vitality has been lost. And between different races, between different castes, the elements of hatred, suspicion, envy, jealousy, and class consciousness has increased. People are madly after money. They are demanding equal rights for money and leveling down of talents. But he says this is creating degradation in the character of people, of society. Says this equality is not possible because equality of talents is not possible because talents are inherent. And there will always remain a distinction between a genius and a fool, an able organizer and a submissive worker, and this differentiation cannot be abolished. Radhakrishna says that society is just like a living organism. And, and it is an organic whole. Therefore, to realize their full potential, the members of a group must share community feeling and a sense of belonging. There are various groups in society, like teachers, traders, farmers, weavers. They cannot work independently and go their own way because it will create chaos in society. So they must share community feeling to realize their full potential. And they should think that service of their fellows is a religious obligation. And whoever denies this obligation, whoever denies this thought, is a sacrilege. He is committing a sacrilege. So Radhakrishnan says that Indian caste system is democratic, not in the sense of money earning, but in spiritualistic terms, because in spiritualistic pursuit, every caste, every community had equal rights, and there was no distinction of caste or creed or status. So in India, there is a just organization of society is just, which is based on spiritual liberty, political equality, and economic fraternity. Says that caste here means not caste here means the character. Caste represents our character. That is, our conduct counts. How we behave in the society counts. Where we has taken birth doesn't matter. Even a chandal, if he leads a virtuous life, if he is of pure character, he will be a Brahmin. So he says, in whichever caste we are born, there is a scope for gradual transformation from the lowest to the highest. And different castes represent members at different stages of self-realization, and every person has some spirituality inside himself, and whoever explores his spirituality to the most, he rises in the hierarchy to the highest rank. He says that so far as a person possesses the qualities of love and imaginative piety, these social distinctions disappear. So it says that Hinduism is in every society, one group dominates the other groups, and in the Hindu society, the spiritual and cultural group, that is the group of Brahmins, that has dominated because they were the self-sacrificing people, they had self-control, and they served their society selflessly, and they had friendliness to all the people. And the economic group was considered to be the lowest. And these, the people who are pursuing the spiritual goals, they become one with the world. And he gives the example of Lord Buddha and Jesus Christ. And their rights are fewer, but their duties are numerous. So we see that Hinduism believes in gradual transformation towards the goal of realization of our ideals. So it has a realistic perspective. Caste, he says, is the quest for character, and one can rise higher in the society by his deeds. He gives the example of different saints. Example, Vashishta was born to a prostitute, Vyasa was born to a fisherwoman, and Parashar was born to a Chandal girl. But because of their conduct, because of their practices of self-control and self-sacrifice, they rose to the level of the highest saints, highest rishis of our society. To conclude, Hinduism is not a primitive religion, which is marred by superstitions and conservatism. Rather, it is a progressive, scientific, democratic, flexible, and modern religion, along with continuity with the past. That is, science of modernity are here, but it has not broken its ties with the past also. It is a living tradition because of its central tenets. However, in the modern world, in the present times, we see some sort of listlessness, lack of vitality, which is creeping into the Hindu thought, and it is all because of political upheavals. So he ends on a note of hope that at present the work of readjustment and restatement of its basic principles is in progress. And he says that to bring world peace, we can follow the example of Hindu thought, that is, which is based, believes in one supreme reality, one supreme spirit, and which believes in tolerance, harmony, and assimilation instead of extermination or subjugation of different races. So this is the end of this, the Radha Krishna's views on Hinduism. Thank you. Thanks a lot.